Canterbury Helston Park RSL Club for our very special first birthday edition of This Is My Life. Today, our guest of honour is the man himself, Mr. Bert Newton.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host, Mark Christian.
Good afternoon. What a pleasure to see your shining, smiling faces. Thank you for joining us this afternoon at Canterbury Helston Park RSL for our first birthday edition of This Is My Life. As you just heard, my name is Mark Christian. Perhaps I should start by asking very quickly, hands up those of you in the audience who've been along to see This Is My Life before, one of our previous shows. Quite a few of you. All right, so I'm preaching to the converted. You're our regulars. All right. Those of you who haven't been along before, let me explain the premise of what this show is about. We started 12 months ago this month because I believe that even though there's not a lot of variety shows on television anymore, like we used to have the Don Lane show, the Mike Walsh show, Michael Parkinson, all those shows where we got to meet and find out about the person behind the performer. Even though those shows are no longer a part of our regular television diet, with perhaps the exception of our guest of honour show today, even though they're no longer on our screens, I believe there's a whole heap of people out there who still want to see that sort of entertainment. So I decided about 12 months ago, as a performer, I used to love watching those shows as a kid, and I decided that if the television stations didn't think there was an audience for it, and if they didn't want to do it, that I was just going to damn well prove them wrong. And instead of doing it as a televised thing, we would do it as a live show. So we started 12 months ago. Since then, we've had lots of guests grace this stage with their presence and tell us their stories. Stuart Wagstaff, Ida Buttrose, Frank Ifield, Carlotta, Tony Lamont, Jeannie Little, Ugly Dave Gray, Maria Venuti, the list goes on and on. We wanted to make sure that we did something very, very special for our first birthday. And so I invited a gentleman who is perhaps the best known personality in this country to be our special guest. He doesn't do too many public appearances, so it took a bit of convincing, but I'm pleased to say that he is with us. Before I introduce him to you, let's look to the screens and relive some of those magic moments in the life of Bert.
Appealing It looks like a super show. Oh, yay!
And it does indeed look like a super show. Ladies and gentlemen, please meet Bert Newton. Microphone is on your chair, my friend. Lovely to have you with us today. Did you get a chance to have a glimpse at any of that footage while you were standing back there?
Well, I couldn't see much of it, but did you repeat a lot of stuff? Because, I mean, I wouldn't have done that much stuff in my career, I wouldn't imagine. But it was a thrill to relive those.
How many memories. Years is it now since you started?
In television. Oh, by the way, good afternoon. It's lovely to see you out there. I'm sitting here like a rabbit on a fence because I was warned by someone backstage not to lean back too much because I've put a little bit of weight on and everything. And no need to laugh. Let's have a look at you. You're nothing to write home about either. I've put a little bit of weight on and so I've got to sit up here like so. I'm sorry, oh yes. I started when television began, or should I say, television didn't begin until I started in television. 57, I went to Channel 7 for a couple of years and did a Tonight Show there. I joined a good friend of mine, the late Noel Ferrier, and then when Noel left the show, after only a couple of months, he didn't enjoy television at that stage of the game. So I went into, this is in Melbourne, Channel 7 in Melbourne, you know Melbourne, it's still there. And I was there for 2 years, and then I went across and joined a friend of mine at Channel 9, a man called Mr. Graham Kennedy, and worked with him on 9. The interesting thing is, actually, that back in those years, the idea was for me to go over to 9, and Graham was then absolute king of nighttime television with In Melbourne Tonight. And they were going to do a show in the breakfast area called In Melbourne Today, and I was going to compare that, so Graham was going to be at night and I was down where I belong in the early morning. But one of the announcers at Channel 9 took ill one night or suddenly drunk or something, and I filled in on a commercial with Graham which was supposed to go for 30 seconds and it went for 28 minutes. So the producer said, forget the breakfast session, and from here on in you work with Graham. The reason I left Channel 7 was twofold, I should have mentioned this. Number one, we had some artistic differences, and secondly, they told me you're sacked. So I thought it was a good enough reason to move over to 9.
Always a good cue. Yeah. We'll talk about all those things that you've mentioned in more detail before we...
Did I say too much then?
No, not at all. Sure. You can say whatever you... I'm not about to argue with Bert Newton, for God's sake. You can say whatever you want.
But speak nicely to me, because I'm a very emotional person.
Well, actually, that's what I wanted to say to you, because the point is that I want to borrow an expression from your friend Tony Harvey, because where I sit right now, with the tables being turned somewhat, you're normally the interviewer as opposed to the interviewee. Yeah. I feel a little bit at the moment like I'm about to sing My Way to Frank Sinatra. I just wanted to know, is it a comfortable feeling for you, or is it something that you would prefer not to be doing? Or?
Well, I don't mind. I usually have a pretty quiet Sunday afternoon, so it was... Nice to come up and have, you know, I mean, you haven't asked me all the questions yet, could be asking dreadful things, but I'll answer everything as honestly as I feel I should. and if in trouble, I'll embellish. Tell me how the other people went. You've had Patty on. How did Patty go?
Patty was fantastic. How many of you are here for Patty? Wonderful.
Yeah.
She was wonderful. She was very warm and very sincere, and she spilled lots of beans and gossip about you.
Right. Was she sober?
She was.
Yeah. Yeah. Was she blonde when she came up?
Yes, she was. Mm.
I thought I'd have to become a Collingwood supporter when I first saw her because of the whitish hair and the black roots. But I... thank God she's not here. Don't turn nasty. I can turn nasty too. And I'm very emotional.
Actually, she talked quite a lot, speaking of hair, talked quite a lot about Oscar.
Let me explain who Oscar is. I think I loathe you.
already?
Yes. Oscar is my hairpiece. Yes, it is my hairpiece, and I'm quite proud of it. It's a little piece that went on there. I would like to think that I'm not...
Oh, hang on a sec. Are you back on?
Yeah. Who's doing audio? Don Lane? No. It's the little piece that I have on now just to... there's a very minute bald spot on my... on my head, and it's just, it's sort of... would you like some? There it is. I'll just put that down
Thank
there.
Thank you, that's lovely.
For good luck.
We will we frame that.
Yes.
Let's go back to the very beginning and look at a photo of baby Bert.
Oh, look at that.
You were born Albert Watson Newton.
Yeah.
In North Fitzroy, Melbourne.
Yeah.
July 23rd, 1938.
Wouldn't you bet I was going to grow up to become a poof? I mean, look at that. Look at the legs and the whole thing. When you have a close look, you know. And the arms behind the back and the whole thing. But a very gorgeous kid, eh?
Bert, tell us about... Paint a picture of Melbourne for us at that time when you were born, because we're talking about pre-World War II.
Yeah, well, I didn't see much of Melbourne when I was born, but it was 1938.
Yes.
So work it out, I'm 65 this year. And Melbourne was a city in 1938 that I guess, like the rest of the world, was in a little bit of a quandrum because of the looming war. It was 1938, the thing. Very much like the atmosphere last year particularly, and I guess eventually it became the atmosphere that it is now with basically a world war. My birth had nothing to do with the declaration of war in 39, but it was... of all the Australian cities, from what I've read and from what my folks have told me, it was... Melbourne was a city which was very, not a self-conscious city, but because of the fact that Sydney was known right around the world, and that was about the only city they knew in Australia, I suppose it had a slight inferiority complex. But it had great radio, it had great theatre, it was the home of theatre in that era. And I think, in fairness, I think even most Sydneysiders would agree that it was the hub of theatre for many, many years. And the radio I refer to, I didn't realise it at the time, but it was going to be pretty important that Melbourne was a city with lots of good radio. And more so than Sydney, they were inclined to give younger people a chance to get into radio, maybe because we work cheaper, I don't know. But it was a city that I grew to love, and of course, as you know, apart from anything else, I'm very pro-Australian, and I've basically never worked anywhere else but Australia. I was born 23rd of July 1938 in a little private nursing hospital. I think there was room only for five maternity cases, and when I was born, including a set of twins, there were six babies there, and I was the only boy at that time, and even I was a bit debatable. But... I think at the time Mum wasn't very well because she was in hospital, as I mentioned to you. And the whole point is, just from here to that piano... You're referring to Oscar again?
No.
From here to that piano away was a hotel which a couple of years later was bought and run for 40 years by a man called Mick Walsh, the father of Mike Walsh. So I was born just a hop, step and a jump from Mike's pub.
Speaking of fathers, tell us about yours. Your father's name was Joseph Newton. He died when you were very young, didn't he?
Yes, I was 11. Dad, the story I could tell, I'm sure, would be mirrored and reflected by many people in my age group. He spent a lot of my years away at the war. I don't have many recollections of my father, even though I was young, but I was 11. But I suppose of those 11 years, I knew him only collectively for about 2 years. And the story I tell, which a lot of people, I'm sure, would be simpatico with, is that at one stage of the game, there was a knock on the front door. I guess it would have been in about 38, 90, 43. And there was a soldier standing there, and I wouldn't let him in. And I didn't realise it was my dad. But we'd always been told, you know, don't let strangers in on the whole thing. And when I think about that, it's quite a poignant experience, but I've had many people... over the years, say they had the same experience, which then makes the story worthwhile, but obviously no one here today has had that same experience. Although, perhaps you didn't know my dad. I don't know.
We've got a shot here of your mum, Gladys, who this was taken when she was 19. Tell us about her. What did you inherit from your mother?
I think not enough, because... not because she's now gone, but... and obviously with the exception of my own wonderful family with Patty and the kids, Matthew and Lauren, I've never met or known anybody in my life who was more important to me and also had the best soul, the best nature of anyone I've ever met. She wanted nothing for herself. She wanted all for her family. The family was her friends. We were her best friends. And because I was the youngest, and I was basically a late family, because I have three brothers. I had two sisters, one I don't remember. I was a babe in arms when she died. I guess she died if I was born in 38, probably in about 1940. There was an epidemic of polio, which was then called infantile paralysis, and my sister Betty died from that, but I don't remember her at all. All I know is that she was a redhead. The other sister, Alice, died back in 1975, and we were extremely close. But with my mother, if I had the choice of inheriting anything, it would be the fact that she didn't have a selfish or jealous bone in her body. Everybody who knew her loved her, and with all the gags that I attempt and with all the fun I try to have with people on television and radio and theatre and elsewhere, there's never a day in my life that goes by without me thinking of her and praying for her and being grateful that she was my mother. She was one of those people. If I had only 10 seconds in which to describe her, each member of the family would think to themselves that they were her favourite. And by that, she just had that ability.
Your mother encouraged you to be a Boy Scout after your father's death. And...
I might mention that's not me as a Boy Scout. I mean, I'm 33 there. That was for a... But I was a Boy Scout.
Yeah. I was just using it as an illustration of the point that I was trying to make. In a way... In a way, being part of the Scouts, though, was responsible, apart from Alice's influence, of getting you really involved in show business, because you went on an excursion with the Scouts to a radio station one day.
I did. There used to be a program in Melbourne called Scouting Around. The man who competed, he'd go around to the various Scout troops and do a show called Scouting Around. And he also compared the Daily Children's program, and he invited a couple of us to come in up and have a look. And there was a huge cutout of a Peter's ice cream cone, the health food of a nation. And he explained what the show was all about. It was called Peter's Pals, and a lot of radio stations around Australia had that show prior to television. And I started going in and went in every day.
How old were you?
37. He said, no. He, no. I suppose I would have been 11, just after Dad died, and I started out on radio as a singer. Would you like me to sing a song?
In a little while, perhaps, Bert. We have a shot here taken during the early years at 3XY, because you not only did you go in there as a fan and listen to the shows, but you also actually became part of the shows at 3XY.
Yeah, that's me as a clown down at the bottom there. And the significant part of that photograph is, apart from myself, everyone else is dead, because it's a long time ago.
1953. What did your mother think about the thought of a young man wanting to be so involved in radio at that early stage of your life?
Well, Mum thought it was a terrific hobby. That, you know, and it was as it was born from scouting, because I was having some trouble in sort of getting everything together after Dad died. Because I believe that in the death of anyone who's close to you, for a while afterwards, there's a guilt of some kind. It's very hard to describe until you actually go through it. And I don't know why I felt guilty, but I did. And I think radio was a saviour for me. Up until that stage, I was thinking of going into religion. But that sort of was then...
Is it true that you actually wanted, as a very young child, you had a great desire to become a nun?
I didn't think it would matter, but I didn't pass the physical. So... I said to them at the time, I said, well, it's not going to make any difference. What am I going to do with it? But they said, no, you couldn't be a nun. So Sister Bonaventure Newton never came to be.
At the ripe old age.
I think I'm slightly out of light here. You're upstaging me, old devil. There we go. Do you like my rose?
It's very nice.
I knocked it off in the dressing room.
Well, it suits you. It's very, very nice. Yes. At the ripe old age of 16, he said, returning to the script as quickly as possible. The ripe old age of 16, you left school.
Yep.
And you went full-time as an announcer at 3XY. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you how...
I had to have my neck corrected firstly before I could... Now you know why they don't want me as a nun.
Apart from the...
Sister Bonaventure.
Yes, Mother.
Wouldn't work, would it?
Apart from...
Father O'Brien wants to see you. Woo! Give me that beautiful story on the bus on Christmas Eve when the bloke got on.
No, please tell us.
Went to grab the little seat there and the other bloke beat him to it. The first bloke said, "That's very unkind of you." The bloke said, "Listen, if you don't mind, I am Father Christmas of David Jones and I'm buggered." And he said, "I'm Father O'Brien from Glebe. Imagine how I feel." I haven't thought of that gag, I reckon, in 40 years, and I think I realise why now.
One very important person who was almost a mentor to you in those early days was a gentleman named Alwyn Kurtz.
Yes, indeed.
Now, many of you, I'm sure, remember the face in the middle of that photograph because he went on to become one of the stars in Homicide.
Yeah.
But he was at that time involved with 3XY. Tell us why he was so special to you and what you learned from him.
He was a fantastic ad-libber. He was the best ad-libber on the station. And I twigged then that ad-libbing was a certain art. I wasn't too sure whether you developed it or whether it came to you or whether it was lying dormant somewhere, but I could see him in a studio when I was his turntable operator, his panel operator, just sit there and ad-lib about anything, and also read a good script too. So, and he was also a bloke who would give you a go. And he died only a couple of years ago, and they asked me to do a eulogy at his funeral, which I did very happily. Well, I was happy that I was asked. I wasn't, you know what I mean. And I just spoke as I felt about him. And if I recall correctly, I just said that he was a master of the medium, radio and television. He became a good actor and he remained humble. And I reckon that's, if you get that combination in show business, it's pretty good.
Because of the amount of public attention I guess you were getting as a result of having, at such a young age, being on air, you had a lot of admirers at that time, particularly a lot of...
What do you mean specifically at that time? What's anything happened in the meantime that I should know about?
But particularly at that time, as this next shot shows, you had a lot of admirers of the opposite sex. And I wanted to ask you about this because when Patty was here...
You are aware that's lay girls, aren't you? No, it's not really. The girl, third from the left, she and I went out for some time. Lovely girl. Her name was Beverly, as I recall. Don't tell me she's here.
No.
Right.
Well, not that I know of, let's put it that way.
And the girl on the extreme right there, I saw last year for the first time in about 45 years. She looked shocking.
She became a nun, obviously, did she?
No. But back there, I mean, look at that. But now, God, you wouldn't know the old place now.
When Patty was here, she did, apart from telling us about Oscar, she also talked a lot about the days prior to your marriage and the fact that you had been friends for a long time. We'll talk more about Patty in a few moments' time, but I just wanted to ask you about one thing that she said, which relates to this particular photograph and around that time, and she suggested in the nicest possible way that during those years you got around a bit.
It was all research. I used to do a program on radio then television called The Bachelor Club, and I was the only bachelor on the staff of 3XY, and at one stage the only bachelor among the announcing and comparing staff of Channel 7. So it just followed that I followed. Nothing untoward.
Of course not.
Oh, no.
Well, we wouldn't expect that. But
of course not.
She did also mention the fact that if there was any overseas celebrity in town, that the very first person to take them out was always one Bert Newton.
Oh, yeah, but I mean that... Did she say that?
Yeah, she dropped a few names.
Oh,
like
kill her when I get home.
Eartha Kitt and, quite a few.
Well, I think it behoves you. If you've got somebody in a strange city and they don't know the place very well, if you can't go up to them and be kind to them and buy them dinner, sleep with them. No, if you... I just think it's our duty. It is our duty.
It's the Australian way, yes.
I was very kind to Tiny Tim too.
And let's not talk about Liberace. Age?
It was never my type, you know, Liberace. Always wanting to fiddle with the keys. I just didn't like it.
Age 18, 1957, yes. You joined
Liberace Channel... married, by the way, you know. He married a beautiful actress called Sally Ronan, I think her name was.
Really? I didn't know that.
On the wedding night, she took the frock off, he put it on, she didn't see him for 3 months. Yes. Amazing.
Channel 7 in 1957. Well, tell us how that happened. How did you move from radio to... Because this is, we're talking about the earliest stages of television in Australia here. How did that changeover happen? Was it something that you aspired to do, or did it happen by accident?
To be totally honest, the one thing I wanted to do in life was to be an announcer, particularly on 3XY. I got that very early in the piece when I was 16, so all my ambitions had been accomplished. And anything that happened after that, I've always seen as a bonus, which I know sounds like a PR line, but it's true. And I was working on air with another gentleman called John Ford, the late John Ford, who very much like Alwyn Kurtz was a mentor and a terrific bloke to work with. And one night, about 3 months before television began, the radio technician called out from the control room. There's a man called Colin Fraser, whom I learned later was the program director at Channel 7, wants to speak to the announcer on duty. And the senior announcer took the call, and obviously Mr. Fraser, about 15 seconds in, said, "Oh, no, not you, the other one." So you can imagine how thrilled he was. He invited me down for an audition at Channel 7. I went down a couple of days later. They sat me in a studio. They asked me to read a commercial, which I did, and they just said then, "Describe your day so far." Well, this is 10 o'clock in the morning. Not much had happened. So I sat there and described my day, and about 25, 30 minutes later, a voice came from the control room saying, "Thank you, Bert, and we'll give you a call." And I learned many years later from a friend of mine who was one of my producers at Channel 7, whom I'd worked with at 3XY. He told me the true story that they left the control room to discuss me, and I'm going off about, you know, my day. And then some emergency came up at the station where the program manager had to say yes or no, or fire somebody, or hire somebody, whatever. And they'd forgotten all about me. And on his business, he went past this control room and saw my head up there, still talking about my day. So he went back to the producer and said, "Now, look, I don't know whether he's the best-looking kid the world's ever known. Thank you, Mr. Fraser. But if he can talk like that, I think we're going to need him at the start of television, because if America is any indication, at the start of television, there are a lot of breakdowns, technical breakdowns." Mm-hmm. And that happened once I got the job and went to Channel 7. I was given the duty of introducing the Sunday night movie, and one particular night I introduced High Noon 7 times because it kept breaking. So I finished up telling them what happened at the end. They weren't particularly pleased.
There was a rather unique way that you, and you alluded to it before, but there was a rather unique way that you you left Channel 7 to move to 9, wasn't there?
Yeah, well, they'd made me an offer 9, and 7 wouldn't allow me out of the contract. And the program manager that I was talking about, he was a man who had a habit of... Lovely man. But he had a habit of, in his office, going to the window and looking out the window while he was chatting to you. So I was trying to get an appointment with him to resign, and he wouldn't give me an appointment. So I thought, I know what I'll do. So he's in his office having a meeting with somebody. He walked to the window and I was out in the street with a loudhailer, just suggesting that I'd like to give my notice. He wouldn't accept it, so I basically resigned on air.
back then. Live, on air.
Yeah, I was live at the time, yep. Yeah, in 1959. But they knew it was coming. And I think in many respects, I've since, you know, retained terrific friendships there. But it's a funny thing. I admire so much about Channel 7, but it's, and I've been there a couple of times, but I've never clicked at 7 as I have at other networks. And I don't know why. Perhaps it's something, you know, I believe that certain people are meant, it's even like theatrical performers, sometimes their performance is so much better in a certain theatre than another theatre, which is not necessarily true, but I just wanted to make up some time.
Fabulous. While you're at 9, it's when you arrive at 9 that you form a partnership that goes on to be legendary. And you mentioned the partnership with Graham Kennedy. You two together, one of the greatest duos of all time. Let's have a look at some video footage and relive the magic of Graham and Bert together.
Cross that line. I'm a cross. He's a cross, really. I said I'd always do this, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it on camera.
And I'll do it to you right in front of thousands of people, and I don't care.
No, we always said we'd do this. I've got to do it tonight to prove a point. One, two, three, and we'll do it. One. Here we go. You ready?
Yes.
Well, all right. One, two, three.
I just have to move this here.
I've got to take it over there because they want it.
Okay, we'll just leave it.
What's wrong? What?
I can't get it out.
I'll get it out for you.
Right.
You've got to breathe in.
Oh,
you've got to get that.
That almost kills you, doesn't it?
Yeah, there you are.
Oh, that's better. Thank you.
I'll just move this pussy.
Okay. I always carry this with me, you know, because you never.
Oh, good. It won't fit through the hole.
Why don't you go first?
Yes.
And then try.
Oh, that's a good idea.
You right?
Yep.
No?
Well, I have to put it over here.
Okay, right. Well, just you know, you never know when those nasty flies and monkeys. What have you done?
I've got to move the big can of pussy because of the next act.
Well, can I help you?
No, just go ahead and do that.
Where do you have to stick it?
Now, you can use plenty of it. Don't be frightened. Dogs love it. Yes. Oh, that's a boy.
Sit. Oh, pardon me.
Sit. Shell Guard has done for Bert Newton since I shampooed him last week.
Oh, what a bad thing.
Look how good he looks. His coat is shiny. His little nose is moist.
Yeah, it is too.
And he finds it damn near impossible to go past a tree without
that. That's disgraceful. By the way,
shut your big face. Your Majesty! Don't sneak up on me like I dropped all my dinner. Frighten hell out of me. Pick up my dinner.
Your Majesty.
Pick it up again. My dinner up. Pick up my dinner. Pick that up at once. Our king is talking.
If you don't pick that up, Bert, you won't be in the next series.
The magic, ladies and gentlemen, of Graham Kennedy and Bert Newton. But as on a serious note, it was around the time of your partnership with Graham on television that you also suffered some ill health, which involved hospitalisation and, can I call it a breakdown? Is that what it was?
Well, they didn't know what to call it at the time. Eventually, they did a lot of tests and things, and what they were calling it was near-terminal dandruff. No. I think it was just... Well, early in the piece in television, I admit that I played it pretty hard and I worked pretty hard. I tried always never to allow anything in my social life affect my work. But I was 24, 25 years of age. I'd just gone through a broken engagement. Lovely chap. I'd just done a trip around the world in which I had to do some commercials, and I made 35 commercials in 9 major cities of the world in 11 days. And I was also at the same time, you know, enjoying myself in London, enjoying myself in Rome, and particularly in Rome, Sister Bonaventure. I guess what you could call it would be... The doctor who looked after me said that it was very similar to some sort of neurosis that some ex-service people have. But I got out of it pretty quickly, and I learned from it too. One thing I did learn was the doctor said, don't tell anyone what the real illness was. And I've discovered since then there's not much chance of recovering if you're in that sort of circumstance unless you can talk about it, you know. And to go around and pretend you've got a broken leg or something, whereas in actual fact it's something quite different. And they don't... I actually had LSD as one of the treatments.
And shock treatment as well, right?
Well, you ask most people who've had shock treatment, they don't even know they've had shock treatment. I didn't know until a couple of years after I got out of hospital. I got a hell of a shock. But that's true, by the way. They tried LSD, and that was the flavour drug of the time, and why anyone would take it willingly, I couldn't believe it. I mean, it's not a very nice experience at all.
You regained your health, and eventually, and came back to TV, and part of the reason that you were able to regain your health was because of the family and friends that surrounded you. You say that in the book that I read that you wrote that you had a lot of support from family and friends, particularly a young lady who you'd known since you were very, very young as a child performer. Both of you had worked together, and it's sort of been an ongoing on-again, off-again relationship between
Tony Lamond and myself? No,
not Tony Lamond. I'm speaking of a young lady named Patty McGrath.
Yes, look at her there. Isn't she beautiful?
November 9, 1974.
Yes.
You marry in Melbourne.
Sarah Patty.
That's right. 300 invited guests.
Yes.
10,000 spectators outside the church.
Yes. Well, Patty came from a very, 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 very big family. To make up the numbers for the Newtons on the other side of the church, I had to go to Central Casting and hire some actors. She had, unfortunately, most of them are gone now, but she had so many aunties and cousins and things and so forth. But there were 10,000 people outside the church, and dear Yoon, Patty's mum, as she arrived in the bride's car, she said, oh, just our luck, there's a football match on the same day, which I think is lovely.
Not realising that everyone was there actually to see the
show. That's right, that's right.
Is it really as peachy keen and happy as it seems, or do you fight?
Well, it's not peachy. What did you say, peachy?
Peachy keen.
Well, no, I think it's just it's a normal marriage, whatever normal means. I always love it when you pick up the paper and someone's been married for 29 years or 40 years or whatever, and they say, and we haven't had a crossword. Well, you think one or two things. What a dull life. Or they're lying. I mean, it's imagine being with any one other person in the world for that length of time. There've got to be moments. And we fight like everybody else, but... we stay together, and there's never been any talk that we wouldn't stay together. We love each other very much. We have two wonderful children. Patty has got a magnificent nature, beautiful attitude on life. I've always believed that regardless of what happens in the careers of Matthew and Lauren and what happens for the rest of my career, unless things sort of change quite dramatically, it'll always be understated just what a wonderful performer Patty is. I mean, she's a magnificent wife and a terrific mother, but she remains in my mind, and I've worked on lots of, you know, talent shows like New Faces for 12 years, whatever it was. And when I was a kid in that radio children's program,
there were, all the entertainers were young children, and she remains in my mind as the best child entertainer I've ever seen. And I saw her do her work over in England and on the QE2. And the only failing that that Patty has is one which you sort of admire, and that is she is a very modest person. But if she had the push that some other entertainers of lesser talent have, God bless them, she would have done even more. She's a wonderful feed in comedy. Graham Kennedy said that she was the best younger female feed that she'd had. Joff was always thrilled with her, Joff Allen, the comedian. And all the other, back I mentioned before, Tony Lamond, when Tony was in a sketch with Patty, there was always a bit of magic there because they're two great performers. I'd like to see something happen. When she was in The Wizard of Oz with Nikki and myself, I think she showed a lot of people what she could do, and unfortunately she didn't do it in Sydney. A lovely girl did it here, Delia Hannan, and no relation to Jimmy Hannan. And then she got pregnant, Delia, not Jimmy, and she had to leave the show, so Patty did Glinda in Melbourne and Brisbane. Sure, this is not too long, and was terrific.
Speaking of too long, Bert, it is time for a break. And
would you like me just to sing one little song? In,
perhaps later. It is time for a break. It is time for a break, and those of you who watch Bert's show will know that when we do have a break, the most important thing to do is to introduce somebody. So, ladies and gentlemen, now here's Moira.
You didn't tell me last night you were going to be here. Thanks for a great night, by the way. That chandelier bit, good, that's fabulous. What about the leather?
Thanks, Bert. Well, today on Buyer's World, we are going to find out a lot more about a brand new seniors magazine designed to appeal to oldies everywhere. Now, it features the usual sorts of articles, I mean, cooking, sewing, knitting, exercise, and we're going to find out a lot more about it by having a chat to their chief correspondent.
Hello, Rosemary.
It's Moira.
What?
Moira.
Who is?
I am.
You are what?
Never mind. Look, tell us all about the new magazine.
Oh, well, it's going to be lovely, dear. It's actually filling a gap that is glaringly obvious for a very large part of people who are not being catered for.
It sounds wonderful, Miss. Actually, what's your name?
Actually, it's Mabel Moffat, but I thought it'd be more professional, so I've changed it to Harmony Charisma D'Alessandro. I think that's more professional, don't you?
Yes. Yeah. What would you like me to call you, though?
Flo.
Flo. Okay, well, let's have a bit of a chat about your position at the magazine. By the way, what's the name of the magazine?
You know, you're only young once, so you might as well make the most of it.
Very true, but what's the name of the magazine?
You're only young once, so you might as well make the most of it.
Okay. Flo, what's in the first issue?
Well, I'm very excited. In addition to all the other duties that I'm doing, I'm going to be reviewing all the new movies that come out. And in this first edition, I'm going to be reviewing Cleopatra, starring Elizabeth Taylor, On the Waterfront, starring Marlon Brando, and Citizen Kane, starring Orson Welles. But the scoop, the big scoop, is I'm going to be reviewing Bert Newton's autobiography.
Flo, the movies, they're really, really, really old. And I know for a fact that actually Bert's book was published in 1977.
Well, I've been really snowed under lately, Kerri-Ann.
It's Moira.
Whatever.
So what is your opinion of Bert Newton?
Oh, well, I'm sure he's a very nice person, but he's made some very strange career choices.
What do you mean?
Well, for instance, when he was trying to lose weight and he made that Jenny Craig ad, do you think it was good of him to refer to himself as the Duchess of Pork? And those two children, oh, they're not much of a credit to him, are they? I mean, that boy looks as though he belongs in some gang, and that delinquent girl, I mean, should she be allowed to make records? And he's gone to the pack, he's grown his hair long, and he's got tattoos, and he can't even use the remote control on the television.
Go.
What?
Are you talking about the Osbournes?
Who?
Ozzy Osbourne, and I really think you meant the Duchess of York a little earlier.
Who?
Oh, never mind. Why don't we actually hear from celebrities now who heartily endorse Bert's book?
Darlings, this book has changed my life. I used to think I was sick, twisted and perverted. But since reading Bert Newton's own story, I've just discovered I'm really quite normal.
Oh, Bert, don't you take any notice of all those bitchy, nasty people, darling. I just adored your book. Unfortunately, I didn't quite finish it because I found it on the floor of a public toilet and some of the pages were missing.
I read it all the time. It cures my constipation.
Who?
Bert.
Bert who?
Bert Newton.
Never heard of him.
If I'm going to be honest, I must say that I was slightly disturbed by the book. I felt it was totally unnecessary to mention the fact that Patty and I had a fruit stall once at the markets. I also found it disturbing that you revealed the fact about that one-night liaison with Maria Venuti behind the sheds at the Fitzroy Football Park that produced the love child, Belvedere. But it explains a lot of things now. Bert, I just think honestly that you should have waited for everyone to die before you released this book. On a personal note, I was hurt to realize that on your list of favorite male singers, I came in at 29, after Kamal and Izzy die. Bert, that hurt.
This book is the story of a man who's changed the face of the entertainment industry here in Australia. A man who's regarded as one of the finest performers this country has ever known. A man who's adored by millions, not only here in Australia, but all over the world for his sincerity, generosity, and undeniable talent. A truly wonderful, wonderful man. But tell me, why are people so unkind?
Well, there you go, Flo. What do you think of that?
Who are these people?
Do you actually know who Bert Newton is?
Not really.
Look for the new Seniors magazine at good news agencies everywhere.
And you can get a copy of his autobiography at any St. Vincent de Paul's for 50 cents.
Thanks, Flo.
Thank you, Oprah.
Back to you, Mark.
Ladies and gentlemen, please thank Moira MacLean. Come over. And also in her guise as Harmony... What is it? Harmony Charisma D'Alessandro?
Harmony Charisma D'Alessandro.
Ladies and gentlemen, the legendary Tony Lamont. Yeah. 1974, you begin another famous partnership
1974.
With... 1974? Yeah, sorry, we'll get there, don't worry.
I'll have to be in a coma between 1981 and 1987.
I'll push you through. Listen, I got through almost 2 hours with Jeannie Little, and we only got up to her seventh birthday by the time we were up to about 90 minutes, so it's fine, don't worry.
Just give me the year and I'll tell you what happened in the year.
1974.
Nothing happened in that year.
Something did happen in that year. A very famous association with another person. Let's have a look to the screen and remember Bert from The Don Lane Show.
There was a young man called Gandhi.
Wait a minute.
Who went into a hotel for a shandy. He lifted up his cloth to wipe off the froth. And the barmaid said, "That's bloody handy."
I love my sister.
Do you?
I really love her. I love her so much I can't tell.
No.
There are people in King's Cross would pay big money for this.
I've seen you there, darling.
Shut up.
And it's unbreakable, as you know.
It certainly is.
Yes.
That's as translucent as the finest china, but it takes a lot of beating.
Ha-ha.
Beat it. Show them how you can beat it. And that is how to get the drinks. They're perfectly chilled.
If ever I see Eddie Fisher, I'll kill him.
I tried.
You must put one leg up like so. Are you with me? Would you please put one leg up like so? Do you mind?
Yes, I do.
You know something, sir? You turn me on. Now, this is Snapdragon now, and you put other leg over yonder. Now, through there. Now we start. Okay? You know what to say, don't you? As a matter of fact, I feel more like Esther Williams.
Can I tell you something honestly? What yes. Are you? You're a mammy, you're not a swami. What are you? I can't call you a swami. What do I call you?
I am an Indian Gungana. Yes, I am one of those men that sits on the mountain and all the disciples say, "Are you going to come down? You're making a fool of yourself up there."
Can I tell you something?
Can I get out of this bloody position?
In all honesty, that's the best your hair has ever looked.
Ladies and gentlemen, Don Lane and Bert Newton. Good times, good memories.
Terrific memories. When Graham left the Nine Network, it was felt that I just serve out my contract, which had 2 years to go, basically doing nothing. And most of the people felt that because I'd worked so closely with Graham and I was identified with him so closely, that it wouldn't be a good idea to put me into the Don Lane Show. And Don's first meeting, I wasn't there, but the first production meeting, he asked for me and basically demanded me. And so that was the start of the partnership. I was in a show that I wasn't supposed to be in. And I remember my first line in an attempt at comedy was, "Go home, Yank." And I've said to Don a couple of times since then, that was the one thing that I didn't want to have happen once I worked with him for a couple of weeks. We had a terrific relationship, a very different one to Graham, because Graham and I were friends before television began. But in Don's case, he was the most generous performer I've worked with in terms of laughs and things. He didn't stop me on anything. And once again, as with Graham, I can't
recall a time when we had what you would call a serious blue. We didn't see a lot of each other because I was doing radio at the same time there, at that time. Someone says the name of Don Lane, and a very nice feeling comes over me because it was a pretty important time for my career. A lot of things came from being on the Lane Show.
You actually did radio together, though, as well, didn't you?
Yes, we did for a couple of years, and it was the highest rating half hour. I did the morning program. Don did breakfast, but we came together for a half hour thing between 8:30 and 9, and I think the rating on that was something like, 28, 29, which is huge for radio.
When most people hear the name Bert Newton, I think that they immediately think Logies. Because that's been such a big part of your career. Let's have a look at some footage which might remind us why the name Bert Newton and the Logies will be forever linked.
Tonight we're very excited about the Logies because for the very first time, they're not fixed. No.
Logie Awards have been held for the last 12 years here in the Southern Cross Ballroom. We were going to change this year, but would you believe around Australia that in Melbourne, the Southern Cross Ballroom is the only place which really hasn't got down the centre a cricket pitch. And it's... Oh, I didn't... I didn't realise, sir, that you were here. But I...
All right, now, yeah. Thank you. This is scary. Oh, look, somebody's fantasy.
Best single documentary. Dear Tony, this is the only way I could get in touch with you.
Someone handed me a script and told me that pufta was the word to use here tonight.
No, it's just a little early for that. If you know. I'd like to wait until we get to the major awards.
I really didn't know that this was gonna happen. And I have an affliction. It's called emotion. And oh shit.
Congratulations, Michael. What times have you been married in the series?
Well, I have this child, you see.
You have a child?
But that...
Out of wedlock?
Right, yes, quite.
Is he still living?
He's 27 years old now.
And obviously, he would have to be for the plot of Homosexual, is he?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, is he?
Yes.
Is he really? Is he really?
Well, nobody knows but his agent.
Actually, I would, Mr. Newton, would you mind? I did promise my mother, you know, that I was going to get the gold Logie. Yeah. And would you mind... Would you mind taking the picture of Mr. Winkler actually awarding me
Certainly.
This one again?
Can
it's going to be a surprise tonight.
Well, I
promise
think, yes,
you,
I feel
when you find
be.
Out who out there wins this, it will be a shock.
I like the boy.
Did you say Roy or boy?
I like the boy. There's something wrong with saying that.
Roy.
Yeah. Hey, hang on. No. I'll change religion. I'll do anything for you. I don't care. What's wrong with saying that? I like the boy.
Boy, you.
I mean, I like the man.
Who's
I like.
You, oh,
yes.
Who's you call boy?
Are we facing in the right direction? Whatever you want to do, I don't care.
1978 Gold Logie winner, Bert Newton.
And some wonderful memories, not only for you, but for us. Let's talk quickly about some of the people who you did work with in the Logies. Firstly, let's refer back to Muhammad Ali. And that incident, which has to be one of the most famous and referred to incidents in Australian television history.
It haunts me.
Does it?
Yeah. I quite often what is forgotten that I had been doing a series of commercials for KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken, with both Graham on his show and Daryl Summers on his show. And one of the lines was, I liked the boy. So that's why I used it. I didn't use it in any way to offend. But once I realised that it happened, I went along for the ride because I believe that Logies are made up of moments, probably much the same as television generally is. And that was certainly a moment from that night. The extraordinary thing about Muhammad Ali, and he shares this with the late John Wayne, their charisma was such that I knew they were in the room before I could see them in the room. They both arrived a little late, not to go on stage, but to sit in the room. And there was just this, you could feel it in the air with both those people, the two most charismatic people that I've had on the Logies. The other thing too with the Logies, I think it's wise, even if I were asked, not to do the Logies again, because as time goes on, and Jimmy would understand this, the sort of feelings I get about the sort of work that I did on the Logies gets better every year. So I want to go along on that ride too. you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do know exactly what you're saying, but I think that there's a hell of a lot of people out there who would be very, very happy to see you walk on stage and host them again.
That's very nice. Thank you. There's a secret to the Logies back then, though, that we haven't got now, and once again it involves people like Jimmy Hanlon and Tommy Hanlon Jr. and Graham and Don Lane and Mike Walsh and Dave Grant, all of those people, to walk out on stage and see the variety of people sitting there in the audience. The first thing I looked for when I came out on stage was Jimmy Hannon's teeth. And I could see that magnificent smile there, and they were all behind you. Not that they're not behind you now, but with the exception of people like Paula Duncan, some actors, and they are mainly the majority of the people in the audience, they sometimes just take it a little seriously, you know. I mean, it's a night in time, isn't it? That's all it is.
John Wayne, you mentioned before, you spent quite a bit of social time with John on his visit to Australia, apart from working together on the Logies. Mm-hmm. What sort of a man was he in person?
Best storyteller I think I've heard ever. He told wonderful stories about Hollywood. I never went to the cocktail parties the night before the Logies for obvious reasons. I had radio to do and the Lane show and also wanted to be fresh for the Logies. But on this particular occasion, I forget why, but I was asked particularly to go, and I was standing there in this reception area having a cocktail or whatever, and all of a sudden this famous Wayne voice said, "Where's Newton? I want to see Newton." And it was me. And what happened, the yacht he had back in America, one of the crew, if not the captain, was an Australian. And when he knew that John Wayne was going to Australia for the Logie, he said, "Look out for a man called Newton," as John Wayne said. And after the cocktail party, Patty and William Conrad and I sat around, and with a TV journalist from TV Week who was a pain in the thing, but we sat around this table, John Wayne and William Conrad polished off two bottles of tequila, but told the most magnificent Hollywood stories, and it's a night that I'll never forget.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Best entertainer I've seen anywhere, anytime. He was in Australia for one Logies, not to appear on the show. He was doing cabaret here. It was the year that Don won his gold Logie, so I guess we're talking 1977 maybe. And he rang Don and me after the show to say it was the best award show he'd ever seen, and he'd love to do it next year. And said, "Oh, you know, we'd be thrilled, and TV Week would be absolutely cock-a-hoop about that." And then nothing else was heard. And 2 days before the Logies in 1978, if I've got the year right, TV Week got a call saying, "What time do I need to be at the hotel?" And, you know, he hadn't been advertised as a guest because a lot of them say, I'm still waiting to make a movie that Mickey Rooney promised me here in Australia. It sort of happens that way. And we all do that when we're in a strange place and we're trying to ingratiate ourselves and say, "You'll promise anything." And we just thought it was one of those, but he was here and he was fabulous on the show.
The last 12 years has seen you as the king of daytime with Good Morning Australia, but also has seen you performing in some wonderful musicals. First of all, Beauty and the Beast, where you played the role of Cogsworth, for which you received a Moe Award. Following on from that, you went into The Sound of Music as the character Uncle Max, where you worked alongside Lisa McCune and John Waters and Rob Guest eventually and lots of people. And then, as you mentioned earlier, Nikki's in today, the star of one of your co-stars from The Wizard of Oz, which you did just recently. We're running out of time. I just want very quickly for you to please explain to us, because a lot of people wouldn't be aware of this. When you're doing a musical and you're doing Good Morning Australia in the mornings, just give people an idea of what a week entails, because nobody understands how many hours you do. I mean, I don't know how you do it when you're doing both of them.
Melbourne's easy because if the theatre show is playing in Melbourne, it's easy because I work in the morning and then I go and do the shows at night. When we go to Sydney, it's not all that hard. We have to record a couple of two GMAs, and that's okay. That's cheaper for the network anyway, and they support me in that. A lot of travel involved. Sound of Music in Perth was quite interesting. I had to catch a couple of red eyes to get back. But the thing is, I'm quite passionate about both jobs, and I find that when I do theatre, I think my work, I'm quite hard on myself, but I think my work on television sort of improves, because inwardly, even in the subconscious maybe, there's something that you have to prove. Physically, it can be done. It's worked on the three shows that I've done, Beauty and the Beast and The Sound of Music and The Wizard of Oz. And
Will you do another?
Oh, I'd love to if the right show comes along. I mean, I'm not built for either, I guess, in talent or for marquee value in theatre for, you know, major starring roles. But if there's a nice support role there, particularly if there's a bit of humour about it, I enjoy it. And I love the company of theatre people. Television is my day job, my real job, but in theatre, it just seems to me the blame is shared more if anything goes wrong. In television, it's you, it's Jimmy, or it's Bert, or it's Graham, or, you know, it's, or whatever. But in theatre, there's a camaraderie. And camaraderie exists in television too, but it's of a different type, because in television, especially the stuff that I do, you know, you do one, and if it hasn't been a good show, you have only 2 or 3 minutes to be upset because you've got to do it again tomorrow and improve on it. In theatre, you can hone in, you know, on the part, and maybe halfway through the season, you're doing it better than you did in the early part of the season. And I've been lucky; I've worked with terrific people, lovely people.
Like Nikki Webster.
Well, yeah.
Please come with me over here.
Yeah.
You may have noticed that we have a barrel over here, and we've been running a competition recently for people who would like to be part of Bert's Wheel, because such an important part of your shows with Graham and Don, yes, of course, was the wheel. Yes. And we'd like you to reach in there, and we will pick somebody out and see if we can we can sort this out.
And what do they get?
Well, we're going to contact them, and they get to spin the wheel, and then we'll see what prize comes up.
Mr. Frank Ifield.
Okay, it's oh, this is a good one. You would pull one like Itzik Sweeney. Itzik Sweeney. Why I would like to meet Bert Newton. He is a nice man, very good TV. Okay, so Itzik Sweeney. Telephone down the back there. Would somebody like to run up and get the telephone number, and we'll see if we can raise...
Oh, we're going to ring someone.
We're going to ring this person on the phone, unless they're in. Is Itzik Sweeney in?
I think he may be at the records office trying to change his name.
Okay. But... Do we happen to have that person on the phone? Do we have Itzik Sweeney? Mr. Sweeney, can you hear me? Yes, you can. Hello, is that Mr. Itzik Sweeney?
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you very much. Mr.
Itzik Sweeney, yes.
That's good. Ratchet.
Mr. Sweeney, my name is Mark Christian. I'm calling you from Canterbury Helston Park RSL Club. I'm on stage with Bert Newton at the moment.
I like that. That's good club there.
Yes, it is a very good club. It's a very good club. I'm on stage with Bert Newton.
I win many times on the machine.
On the poker machines, do you?
Machine, yes.
That's good, Mr. Sweeney. I have Bert Newton here with me on stage, Mr. Sweeney. All the audience can hear you at the moment. And you're the winner of our competition.
Hello. Yeah, no. Hello.
They can all hear you. You, in fact, are the winner of our of our competition.
Hang on once. I want to check to see if Jimmy's still in the room. Yeah, he is. I thought he might have been in the manager's office playing that role.
No.
What I win?
Well, nothing as yet, Mr. Sweeney. We haven't actually spun the wheel, but I'd like to introduce you via phone to Bert Newton. Would you like to say hello to Mr. Sweeney?
Mr. Sweeney, hello. How are you?
Good, thank you. I see sometimes on television...
Well, see me more often, Mr. Sweeney, if you want something nice from the wheel. Would you like me to roll it for you?
Yes.
Roll the wheel.
Are we going to roll the wheel for Mr. Sweeney? Whereabouts are you from, Mr. Sweeney?
Latvia.
From Latvia?
Latvia.
Latvia, that's... How long have you been in Australia?
Maybe I've been here four years.
How come you're not a cab driver? You're right to go with this?
You see, I see you in morning, you make me laugh.
Oh, that's good. I wish you were here today, Mr. Sweeney.
Why, no one laughed to you now?
Yeah. What did Mr. Sweeney say?
When he said nobody's laughing at you now. He was asking a question.
Must be tuned in.
I should, before you spin that, Bert, come back over here.
You have good-looking wife better than mine.
Oh, I there you are.
My wife much bigger.
She's much bigger.
She's a bigger woman.
Oh, right. What's her name? Mrs. Feeney, I suppose.
Gretchna.
Pardon?
Gretchna.
Irechna.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Gretchna.
Well, give her our love, won't you, if you...
You want...
No, I don't, thank you. I'm very happy.
Wait. I can talk. Wait. You want I should sing for you...
No, listen.
If I can't sing on this little concert, you're not going to sing, Mr. Sweeney. Will I roll the thing?
Bert.
No,
yes.
Bert, come back here.
No.
I should... Mr. Sweeney, please hold on for a moment. I should let you in on a little secret. Ladies and gentlemen, this voice does not belong to Itzik Sweeney. On the other line, from California, Mr. Don Lane.
Aha!
Hey, Bertram, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you, Don. How are you doing?
Pretty good, I think. I was checking around, and Mark Christian tracked me down and said that they were doing this whole evening for you, and I'm really annoyed that I wasn't there.
Oh, well, it would have been terrific to have you here. How are things over there? Still doing the
pretty
paper
good,
round?
Pretty good. I'm over here, you know, mostly because of my son, and he's trying to get this basketball scholarship, which I think we might have very soon now.
PJ, so I should mention to people here, PJ, your son, is a wonderful basketballer and, more importantly, a terrific young bloke. Is he happy and well over there?
Yes. Yes, thank you. What's not to be happy about? I do the laundry, I do the cleaning, I
sure.
do the dishes, I do the shopping.
What's happening on the romance scene?
Hello?
Yeah. Oh, I've got news. I've got news for you too, by the way, Don.
Yeah.
You were wrong a couple of years ago. Jimmy Hannon's not dead. He's here this afternoon.
Did he bring his teeth?
It just occurred to me, Don. It was not until this moment on stage when you and I once again got to the wheel and had this fun this afternoon. I now realise why they dropped the show. Mate, it's great to talk to you. When are you back?
I'm not quite sure. I think probably around September I'm coming back. I've actually got a couple of things I want to do. I'm going to go on a little touring.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Don, is it? Can we make you promise to us now over the phone in front of the 600?
Never mind that. Wait a minute.
In front of... Hang on.
Now, wait a minute.
Oh, there's a blue
I'm
one.
I'm being told now. Watch out.
What did I win?
What did you win?
Yeah.
You
what
have,
is this? I
you
get
have...
on the phone for 15 minutes. Hey, I did it for nothing, and you don't even give me anything.
We're going to spin the wheel.
Oh, okay.
and you've landed
number
on...
Number 12, yeah. And you know what that is? A fortnight... A fortnight in Fiji with James Randi. Isn't that wonderful?
Well, these days I'm glad somebody's Randi.
I should tell you, Don, I tell you what, you have won, Don, with all sincerity. You have won an opportunity to perform on stage here at Canterbury Hilson Park RSL when next you're in Sydney. Will you do that?
Absolutely.
Don, thank you so much for being part of this hookup today. I know that you were most disappointed.
Is Tony Lamond out there?
Yes,
Tony Lamond is here.
Surprised. And guess who else is here? Tommy Tico is here.
Well, I bet Crocker is there.
Barry Crocker is here.
Yeah, he shows up for the opening of a refrigerator.
Yeah. Kamal can't make it because...
Thank God for small favors.
Yeah. Lovely
hey, listen,
talking
Bert,
to you.
Has anybody told you lately that they love you?
No.
Well, I do, and so do all of those people there too, mate. You're great.
Lovely. Thank you, Don.
Ladies and gentlemen, please thank Don Lane.
May I sing a song now?
All right, go on.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce a good friend of mine, the wonderful pianist, Mr. Michael Tyag.
Where are you, Michael?
Welcome, mate. Welcome. There you go. What would you like, a ballad, or would you like... We'll try the ballad, if that's okay. There you go. Off you go.
Unforgettable, that's what you are. Unforgettable, so near, so far. Like the song of love that clings to you, how the thought of you does things. never before has someone
not yet.
Unforgettable.
In every way. And forevermore. That's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Would you dance with me, Mark? Thank you. You're such a lovely dancer. Could we pivot? Oh, not Nikki.
Yes, Nikki Webster.
I'm sick of hearing about your girlfriends. And she's one of them. He always liked younger
Should
women.
We change? Let's change over. Please thank the lovely Nikki Webster and Mark Christian. Be careful getting down those steps. And thank you, Nikki, for coming. She's the best girl in the world.
Unforgettable. In every way.
And forevermore. That's how you'll stay.
Time step.
That's why, darling,
it's incredible that someone so unforgettable
thinks that I am unforgettable.
Big note.
There you go.
Patty, thank you, darling. Bert, come over here. You two have made sure for all of us that this afternoon truly will be unforgettable. Thank you so much for coming to Canterbury Helston Park RSL.
Hang on, I just have to check.
Yeah, everything's fine there.
It's all right. Yeah. You know what?
What?
He doesn't only have one piece on, he has all little bits too. You know, and it's the little bits you got to worry about.
Hey, do you want me to tell everyone that sometimes you borrow it?
And
then I'll tell them where you'll wear it.
He wanted mine and I wouldn't give it to him.
Wasn't the hair I was talking about.
We went out to dinner the other night and he came home a little tipsy.
She'll never get off now, you know.
And you know what? He took Oscar off, but he forgot about the little bits. And when we woke up the next morning, guess where the bits were? On the pillow.
Right. I'd like to thank this little bit for being with us. It was just great to have my beautiful wife come out as such a surprise. And thanks to Michael Tyack too.
Thank you very much, Michael.
Thank
you very, very much. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll have the opportunity to meet Bert and Patty in a couple of moments' time. They'll be down here. We have photographs for you. They'll be happy to sign them for you. Thank you so much, both of you, for coming. I don't know how to thank you. You've made my day. It's been one of the most exciting moments of my life to have you on stage with me, Bert.
Thank you,
Patty, for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, Bert and Patty Newton.